the designer of the game, is unknown. Nobody knows where he's from, who he is. The game that we're playing next is Dota 2.
Radiant's turn to ban. Seconds. Dire's ban now.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Ucypher Nesport Nes Superstars. My name is Vivek, with me is CloudX, and you're watching the Crusaders take on the Sherdils. The Crusaders causing an upset of sorts here. Winning the game of Counter-Strike, it was mighty close. I think the final scoreline was 16-14, but the Crusaders, they're coming in with a wave of confidence. And Sherdils, they've lost their last two games of Dota 2.
We have seen Sherdils show a spark of brilliance in the past as well. They've taken games off some teams that we thought were impossible to beat back in the day. Sherdils, they're going to open up with the Venomancer ban. Second ban on the board for them will be revealed shortly. It's going to be the Pugna ban. While Crusaders, they're going to go ahead and remove the Brewmaster. Now, this is something that we've seen exclusively run by the Marksman. Reds run the Brewmaster on one game in the past, if I'm not mistaken, but Crusaders believe that it's worthy of a first ban here. Is this an indicator of a heavy physical DPS goal to come on the side of Crusaders, or is this just a preference ban coming out versus the Shield?
5 seconds remaining. Dire's ban now.
It's also partly the fact that Sherdils, of Khans in particular, was running the
Dire's turn to be tied on.
Not even surprising, man. Tide's just turned into an absolute beast of late. What's going to be the storyline of this game is going to be Sherdils and Khans, if he can manage to make those massive plays once again. The last time he got his hands on the Darkseer, unfortunately, there wasn't something like a Disruptor to follow it up. There was only a Sven, which was an unrealistic combination to expect time and again. Sherdils, this time around, let's see how they're prepping for the mid-game stage. They're going to open up with the Doom ban. Is this going to be Khans on the Doom?
Possibly. I'm not a fan.
Yeah, I don't think this fits his playstyle in particular, because he's one of those high impact initiation type players that jumps in and catches multiple heroes with AoE spells. Perhaps the Batrider would have been more up his alley, but unfortunately that's been banned out by Crusaders. The Darkseer is something that we know he loves running, but you can't have him be the one trick pony on the side of Sherdils. It's probably the reason why they've gone ahead and picked up the Doom for him.
Okay.
Crusaders though, that Tidehunter pick, can't really find any faults in it. It's something that's working wonders at Ucypher here. And going for the first pick Tide, it's something that Crusaders have really been thinking about of late. We heard them have this conversation earlier on outside over a cup of tea as well.
Yeah, Radiant's I'd like to see the Sherdils pick 4 and 5 positions that A, have a lot of magic damage, and B, also offer team fight, because you want multiple team fight coming out to be able to deal with the Tide, and there's a new green in town. It's the Medusa.
All right, strap your seatbelts in, ladies and gents. Looks like we're in for a long one. The Medusa, not really known for her early game prowess. She's a hero that's meant to come online post the 40-minute mark. And that's pretty much going to be the game plan here for Crusaders. Get Medusa fat to the point where she's nigh unkillable. Have the Tidehunter standing behind, waiting to jump in with the counter initiation damage. And just have Medusa chipping away on the towers from range. Crusaders, sparing no expenses, they'll ban out the anti-mage right from the get-go, leaving Sherdils with limited options to deal with that Medusa's mana shield. Now, the options as of now continue to remain the Mirana as well as the Invoker. I'd expect at least one of these to be banned out by Crusaders. But it is going to be the first pick in favor of Sherdils after this next phase of bans. So they have the option of picking up the other one. And it's not like they've revealed their mid or their one position picks either. This is a good game for the Invoker though. Sand King Invoker, plenty of synergy with the Burrow Strike and the Sun Strike in the early game stage. And of course the EMP works wonders versus the Medusa. I'd be surprised if Sherdils didn't pick up the Invoker here.
What do Sherdils want to ban then? I mean, they're kind of generic. What do you want to ban which is somewhat good with the Medusa?
Draw Ranger perhaps? If it's going to be a draw strat?
Just another Undying, which is cheese, but cheese is working.
Here. Yeah, cheese is working. And Undying, Tidehunter, and Medusa, I don't know how you kill any of those three heroes then in that mix. Maybe you go for the Ancient Apparition on the side of Shades.
It's band.
Not the most reliable way to deal with the Tide, but given his huge HP boost, it's a little bit easier to get the Shatter to connect on him. It's come to a point where the only real ways to deal with the Tidehunter are to throw magic damage at him from range. You get in close, take an Anchor Smash to the face as a physical DPS score, and you're going to do no damage to him whatsoever. We've all seen that ever so famous clip of Resolution putting out the question mark when four of them try to kill the Tidehunter, and that's exactly what Crusaders are going for here. Remaining. Picking up two super tanky cores as their first picks. We have the Monkey King ban coming out from the Crusaders. That's another hero that does well versus the Tidehunter in the laning stage. But both the Invoker and the Mirana are left in the mix, and honestly, I think Sherdils should pick them both up here. They're gonna go with the Winter Wyvern for now. Not a big fan, considering Medusa is a natural Lincoln Sphere builder, but at the same time, the Winter Wyvern does offer some late game security versus the Divine Rapier Medusa. But look at this, Crusaders are gonna play dirty. It's hard enough to deal with one version of Medusa, getting two additional illusions of her standing side by side, that's gonna be painful. Not to mention the defense that Shadow Demon brings to the table versus the Doom. I'm a little worried here for Shields.
Mm-hmm. I like the Winter Wyvern pickup. I mean, Medusa is hard. She probably puts a point in a split shot. If you get a good Winter's Curse off, Medusa is probably gonna end up killing that Shadow Demon unintentionally. I like the Winter Wyvern pickup. It's good versus lineups which are physical damage heavy. And it's going to cause problems with the Medusa, and she's got to be careful with the positioning. She can't afford to be caught out of position, otherwise she's instantly going to be killing a teammate. The Cold Embrace is also going to be nice.
Radiant's turn to
but yeah, like you mentioned, Shadow Demon and Medusa, this is utterly disgusting. And I'd like to see the Crusaders pick up something like Mirana and the Invoker. Because we now... What?
Okay then, they're just going all in with the push. So they're going to play tank. Fantastic reaction, by the way. They're going to be playing tank Medusa, Luna's going to be running on the core one position, and Shadow Demon is going to be making cancer spread all across the map.
I can see the Crusaders on stage, they're laughing.
10 seconds.
They're having fun, fine enough. But yeah, I honestly don't mind the Invoker and Mirana pickup, because one of the changes in 7.07b or 7.07 is that you now actually have a time indicator for disruption. So setup is like ridiculously easy now.
Make this game more noob friendly, will you guys?
But I think they need a support. So they're looking for another support. Heck, even the support Mirana.
So Sherdils has that Juggernaut going for them, which should be a Diffusal Blade coming out on him for that Medusa. Blade Fury is pretty good versus the Tidehunter as well. It's magic damage, so Tidehunter is not going to be able to shrug that off with the Anchor Smash. There's also the fact that a well-placed Blade Fury could evade a Ravage in the middle of a fight, which could then allow him to come back with the Omni Slash as well. The problem is, Shadow Demon can still control the Juggernaut. If you score Illusions of Diffusal Blade Juggernaut, you're going to end up taking out the Juggernaut by yourself. Demonic Purge does slow him down even through the Blade Fury, so I feel like Shadow Demon is more than enough to deal with a Jug. Add to this the fact that Crusaders are going to have a Luna that's most likely going to be rushing a Manta style this game. More Illusions means more Omni Slash targets, which means a less effective Omni Slash on the side of Sherdils. But on the flip side, the Winter Wyvern does work versus the Luna. It's unlikely she's going to be getting the Lincoln Sphere for herself, so that Winter's Curse could rip her a new one, especially if the Medusa goes for some DPS items towards the later stages.
I remember having a word with Opa, and he was asking who's picking up MVPs, who's doing well in terms of supports, and he's a 5 position, and like it's honestly a little difficult for a 5 position to pick up an MVP. If there ever was a game for a Winter Wyvern to shine, this is it. This is Opa's turn to shine. There's a lot he can do. The Cold Embrace and the Winter's Curse are going to be huge.
Yep.
I just like... I'm actually a little disappointed that the Sherdils banned out the Tinker, because if you hark back to the Shadow Demon Luna era, the Tinker was one of the better ways to hold against the push.
You bet it was. But at this point, I think their priority should be to take down those illusions ASAP.
Yeah.
The problem is they don't have room for a Lion or a Shadow Shaman to Hex or Mana Drain those illusions to death. They have room for a Pugna pickup, but...
Pugna's banned, OD's banned.
Oh, right, Pugna's
OD's banned as well. So, I mean, the only way you win this game is you start pushing earlier than them. You never let the Luna and the Shadow Demon come online.
Problem is you're pushing into a Medusa that's still tanky without items and a Tidehunter for a follow-up Ravage.
Jesus, split shot and glaives and just Tidehunter standing in the front. How do you approach
you
it?
You
gotta pop a smoke.
What? You have to wrap around. There's no other way to get into the fight here.
So you either push early or you really rack your heads as to how you can win this draw.
How does Sherdils even push early though with a lineup that has no tower takedown potential at all at the moment?
It's just a Juggernaut for now. It's probably Sand King or the Doom who are going to choose between the 3 and 4 position.
I mean, if you're in the driver's seat for Sherdils right now, your last pick... there's no right answer at this point. You need feedback. Or rather, you need the mana burn for the Medusa. That's not going to come in the form of a tower pusher. You need a way to deal with this ridiculously tanky Tidehunter. If you commit the Doom on the Tidehunter, Medusa is going to be running around the map. Not a fan of Timbersaw. Sniper, I'm not sold by this. I'm not sold by this at all. I mean, I get the mindset going into this one. He's just going to stand far behind on the back lines and try and chip away at whoever's coming in to take the tower. He could possibly go for a Diffusal Blade of his own, which would help versus the Deucer, but that's what the Slaughter's for, that's what the Illusions are for. But then again, if Crusaders does make a truck ton of mistakes in their positioning, that's when the Sniper could really punish. Mm-hmm. Alright, Sherdils are going to round out the draft with the Sniper. You have the Slaughter on Crusaders, who should be on the 4 roll. Lots of ways to amp up damage output versus single target heroes. They've got the Amplify Damage and the Soul Assumption, both of which will work wonders versus the squishy little Sniper. Juggernaut is going to be handled by Rival this game. A lot of pressure upon him to make early movements and make space for the Sniper.
He has to pick up the Battle Fury as soon as possible. And he has to pick up something like a Butterfly.
I don't know if the Battle Fury is really the choice, to be honest.
What does he go for?
I think you just go Mobility and you get yourself the Diffusal Blade ASAP. Your whole goal is to fight, not
He's
farm.
He's going to fear illusions. I mean, not Juggernaut, but maybe Juggernaut gets armor and then he can stand
To be fair, I don't think Battle Fury is really going to help clear illusions. Sure, there's cleave damage and all of that, but you're then going to be running into an army of illusions that are going to be right-clicking you with a Shadow Demon waiting to Demonic Purge you. Battle Fury is not going to help in that regard. Theoretically, it makes sense, but in reality, it's not like it's a one-on-one between Juggernaut and the illusions.
Yeah.
You go all in. You basically make sure you dominate the early game and get into the base by mid game before the Medusa and the Luna can come online. And you have to do all of this only with the assurance that Doom is going to always Doom that Tidehunter before the fight breaks out. Because if a Ravage connects in the fight, that's the setup for the Stone Gaze and that's also the setup for the Eclipse, which will really send the House of Cards tumbling for Sherdils. Anyway, as always, we have the great Indian amateur Dota pause coming out.
Yeah. G. Kamlesh. Khan's having fun. He's a happy-go-lucky guy. I mean, happy-go-lucky is such a Bharat matrimony description of oneself. But Khan's is really always enjoying himself. He's always got a smile on his face. He wins, he loses. He just looks forward to the next game of Dota.
Yeah, he's in it to get good and... Yeah, they're the highest tiers of Dota.
He's just 2021. I mean, what I just realized, thanks to being here on set and watching these games on Ucypher, is that there's so many 20, 21-year-olds, and there's so few good experienced players. That's what I've noticed. There's so many 20, 21-year-olds who have potential. It's good that we're seeing some of these step up, like how we did at the Taiwan Excellence Cup. More of these youth are taking leadership and are approaching the game more holistically. But yeah, there's a whole bunch of young talent. You got Invincible on the side of Crusaders, you got Khans, and a whole lot of them. Most of these people, I haven't even heard of Remstar.
Yeah, he's like a dinosaur from an age gone past now.
Yeah. There's now a generation gap in Indian esports. Never thought I'd get to see that. But yeah, I'm not convinced by the Sherdils and this draft this.
Yeah, I'm not convinced either.
They've got to win mid really heavily on the Sniper. I hope they do. the only thing that's working for them is that Winter Wyvern. I'm sure he's going to have some sort of impact in fights. I hope they do give him some farm priority. So just manage to get in position to get that Winter's Curse. Gets level 6 early.
The good thing about a Sniper versus Medusa draft is, at least in the laning stage, the Sniper should have the upper hand.
He should, right?
Yeah, he's got a more efficient way to push out the creeps, and he's gonna stay a mile away from that Mystic Snake to tag him. So, unless he makes some severe mistakes, he's gonna dominate that lane.
Yeah.
The only issue is, with the rotation from the Shadow Demon and the Slada, the Sniper doesn't survive at all. You're gonna have to bank on Opa coming in and saving him with the Cold Embrace, but that's only gonna delay his death. Because once that Cold Embrace wears out, I'm pretty certain they're just going to wait to repeat and kill him off all over again. Theoretically, Remstar can win the middle lane if he gets a truck ton of support, but if I'm not mistaken, okay, it is Remstar that's going to go towards the middle lane.
Yeah, so this switch things up. Invincible is now the one position and Remstar plays the two position. Both teams smoking. It's Sherdils who popped theirs earlier. They seem to be in a better position. Khan's leading the charge, holding onto his skill point. Opa with that Arctic Burn is going to be doing a lot of damage. Disruption, the smoke dispel. Senjin, look for the disruption. He goes in. He's managed to control the Winter Wyvern. The crush to follow through. Winter Wyvern controlled. Opa with the Arctic Burn flying away. Disruption, Burrow Strike onto the Shadow Demon. Khan just running around with the Scorch Sword, not really targeting anyone. And the fight fizzles out. Mamacita joins the fray. But he needs to be careful. Bakemono is moving in for the crush. The Shadow Demon is there, the Burrow Strike lifts, and Bakemono says thank you for the opportunity. Goes in with the crush, the Mystic Snake is there, and Bakemono with the last hit gets first blood.
It's a little more troublesome than just the first blood, because now they're going to get the Bouncy Runes in the jungle for sure. The money goes over to Bakemono, who's going to pick up his next few items as well. And the Mystic Snake also tagged three heroes. So this is a base trip for Opa, a base trip for Khans perhaps, and well, Mamacita. At least he's going to be able to reset the lane.
Yeah. He's going to make use of that level 1 TP block off the mid wave, and Opa is going to probably do the same.
Look at what Darshan started with, by the way. Yeah. 10 tangos in the mango, the standard healing regeneration build coming out from him. And this is the right choice here. I don't think Ring of Protection would have really helped his cause as much, but I'm not entirely sold by the magic wand being completed this early on. I mean, what are they going to spam here?
Splinter Blast? I don't know.
I don't think that was necessary.
I don't think Disruption can really trade with the
Hell no, he can't.
Opa needs to come in. That Arctic Burn does a fair amount of damage early on. He hasn't got a Stout Shield, so... I mean, Darshan needs to be careful. I'm not sold on the wand as a pickup like you mentioned.
So, the Stout Shield's not a great item because I don't think it really stacks with the Kraken Shell.
Okay.
So, I think its efficacy wears off after the first
level. I think Disruption is pretty much secure to kill on Darshan. He's just gonna TP out, but they got the damage. Well done.
Mostly because, well, the Winter Wyvern is really good in the lane versus the Tidehunter because the Arctic Burn is the percentage of HP and Tidehunter naturally has a high amount of HP, therefore taking a high amount of damage from the spell. Mm-hmm. So it works well in these early stages. Like we talked about, Rival also has that Blade Fury available, which is magic damage.
Yeah.
So the Anchor Smash really doesn't work versus him. But yeah, Darshan goes down, his TP ineffective. And it looks like Disruption's even going to wait to take away his Bounty Rune this time around.
Yeah, moves onto the low ground, takes an Anchor Smash. Darshan just marking territory here. He's going to get his Bounty Rune.
Is he though? Disruption has the Burrow Strike if he wants to contest this.
Actually, they're going in. Opa has the Arctic Burn. The Juggernaut isn't there, but they're going to do some damage. It is only a level 1 Tidehunter. Disruption picks up the Bounty Rune.
Dead.
Look at that. They shoot through more than half his HP. There's 9 Tangos. Are going to be doing some serious work, but the TPs are coming in. It's sending with the Disruption. Bakemono TPs in from the north. The crush should be there. Disruption. He's put his point in the caustic, so there's no sandstorm. Quick Burrow Strike, hoping to survive. 2 stacks of Shadow Poison upon him. He's almost certainly dead. Link up 3 in the crush. And then the Cold Embrace. Not enough for the Shadow Poison is magic damage. Good rotation coming up from Senjin and Bakemono here.
Bakemono still giving Opa a hard time. He's hit him about 4 times here, forcing him back under his tower and forcing him to use that tango. 2-1, Crusaders turning a crappy situation into a good one there. Darshan.
Okay.
Still taking a hell of a beating from Rival, by the way.
My DOTA just crashed.
Okay then. Well, while you reconnect, Invincible on the bottom lane, he's busy free farming. He's at 17 and 9 CS right now, commanding the lead in terms of CS as well as net worth. It is going to be the Ring of Aquila into the power transfer stuff. It remains to be seen whether he's going to go for the Dragon Lance after, or if he's just going to rush that Mantis type.
Welcome back, land lover. Get any salt in your lungs?
Okay, quick reconnect after the DC. Hopefully, you guys still have camera controls. And what did I miss? Well, it seems as if they're prepping for a gank in the mid lane. This is easy. Mamacita needs to be careful. He's got the fairy fire, but it's not going to be enough. Remstar walks ahead, 2 points in the mid. Snake, the crush is there, but here comes Opa. He should have been there a bit earlier, but the cold embrace is going to buy Mamacita time. The shadow poison upon him, crush number two will come. They're looking for a kill in exchange, and Makimono stays alive. Maybe he won't. What?
He walked back through the shrapnel.
And it's Mamacita who got the kill.
He actually sprinted back through the shrapnel, so that makes it all the more worse. The issue with Cold Embrace as a defensive measure versus a Shadow Demon is that you're essentially buying the SD enough time to get one or two additional stacks of Shadow Poison upon you.
Yeah.
And that's all magic damage that's being collected and gonna come at one shot later on.
Damage.
Shadow Poison is one of the stronger spells in the early game. If you get multiple stacks upon a hero, it can be devastating. Sort of like the Static Storm at level 6 from the Disruptor.
Mm-hmm.
But Khans on the bottom lane, looks like he's going to be the one that's going to be banished for now. They got a Shadow Poison upon him as well. Invincible does have the Lucent Beam. But Sand King was here. Senjin takes a Burrow Strike to the face and gets slowed by the Caustic, burnt by the Scorched Earth. And now he's a broken man as Senjin falls to Khans.
I mean, they could chase the Luna. They have another Burrow Strike. The Scorched Earth has worn off, but Khans has the nuke. The Hadouken Beam does its work. And Khans goes a double kill, one of them being on the Luna. This is painful for the Crusaders. And you know what's worse? Atul isn't winning the mid lane at all. 25 last hits, 11 denies. The mid lane has been a whitewash of sorts here.
Yeah, it would have been sort of a recovery after that kill on the sniper. Problem is, sniper got a return kill on the Slada after as well. So it kind of evens out and the sniper continues to win the lane quite hard. As you can see on the net worth charts, it is Sherdils that are commanding the top three positions, with Doom now getting up there after the double kill. Can't stress how crucial that was. It's going to get Khans' level 6 a little earlier than the rest of the heroes on this map. And
they're trying to find a killing response here. Bakimono goes ahead. The crush connects on Khans. Disruption
really
looking for the Burrow Strike. Khans dropping low. Is Wintervival going to DP? Disruption. Consume this clarity. Burrow Strike upon the Slada. Khans caught in another crush. Pops the stick. Wants the mana, but the magic damage too much. They work hard, but they finally get that kill.
I was a bit skeptical about that one. I mean, with the Unholy Aura and the Scorched Earth, I thought that Khans would have stayed alive through it all.
I'm kind of not entirely convinced with Opa's decision making during that gank. It was so close to a tier 1. He had 2 points in Splinter Blast, the Cold Embrace as well. Had a TP, but decided to hang back for the bounty rune. When the enemy 5 is starting to get aggressive, you should be looking to make similar movements yourself.
That's the point of the Wintervive in this game. I mean, he's got to be the defensive measure that stops this early aggression coming out from this Slada, Shadow Demon, roaming duo.
It's not like he's maintaining creep equilibrium in the top lane. It's not like he's pushing Daoshin out of the lane. He just stood still for a good 10 seconds waiting for that bounty rune.
Yeah, he's doing nothing right now. I mean, maybe he's going to try and score a kill here on Darshan's side, but Rival
is basically... With the Omni Slash, it could be possible.
Rival needs one more creep to die in the vicinity, though.
Yeah. Opa should have just waited a bit. I mean, Darshan sensed that he was in a safe space. He should just wait for Rival to pick up six.
Look at what Senjin and Bakimono are doing again, though. Now they know that Opa is busy.
Opa does have a TP, Zalik Burton.
Oh, Bakimono.
Bakimono crushes a hero before he even TPs into the lane, and Khans, without any lockdown, will not be able to find this kill. Disruption, still searching.
Yep, good presence of mind from Senjin there. He knew that the Sand King was TPing in. Instead of just backing off immediately, he stops to shoot out a disruption on the Sand King and then runs back through the south side.
So this isn't an effective TP from Opa.
It kind of is, I'd say. I mean, at least it thwarted the gank and Doom stays alive through it, so it works. Meanwhile, Darshan survives an Omni Slash on the top lane.
Yeah, it's going to be hurting Rival a bit. This goes to show the impact of not being able to purchase Blades of Attack from the side shot. Maybe if the Juggernaut had his face boots, he could have just run up and scored that kill.
Darshan's also got a Shrine at the ready here. He's waiting for Remstar to come in. Remstar's just been walking from Shrine to Shrine, by the way. He's falling behind so far in terms of CS and net worth. The sniper is having a field day here. Mamacita is going to be a force to be reckoned with in this mid-game stage. I really feel like Bakemono and Senjin need to be focusing a lot more effort on killing Mamacita than they are going for the game.
Yep. Bakemono for now, sprinting through the river, moving towards the top lane. Unlikely he's supposed to kill, but he goes in with the crush. Darshan doesn't have the ravages yet, he's only level 4. So this is a little bit of damage. Rival says, hold on, I think I can win this man fight. And just runs down Bakemono with the Blade Fury. Bakemono pops the fairy fire, doesn't survive. A hideous laugh on stage for that kill there. Rival quite enjoying itself. Meanwhile, bottom lane, there's Coda Kill on the Invincible, Disruption diving. Low on mana, needs another 10 if he wants another Baro Strike. Remstar's made a rotation as well. And I think Remstar's hinting that, guys, I can't win the mid lane, please give me the safe lane.
I instinctively facepalmed watching what Bakemono did up there. He sprints into Rival. Now Rival also gets a kill on the Tidehunter as well. Yes. He's just decimating his lane by himself. The draft means nothing if Sherdils are just going to outplay their opponent.
Exactly, I mean, if your cores aren't just having like any semblance of farm early on, the Medusa and the Luna don't mean much. The Luna and her illusions only hit hard, provided that they have some farm and items on them.
Okay, we're now looking at Invincible, taking the weight of this team on his shoulders. He's at 3.4k net worth and is the highest farmed hero on the side of the Radiant. They did use an Eclipse earlier on. Bakemono with another Whiff Crush.
Disruption could go in, but he wants the Luna so much better. They move in with the Pulse Strike. Bakemono doesn't have the custom doom committed. The Assassinate as well. This should be a kill. Khan's going in with the Hadouken Creep for good measure. And Bakemono, crush after crush, not resulting in anything. Has to back off. Disruption though, he's got 3 points in the Baron Strike.
What is Rival doing on the top lane though? Why is he just scoring kill after kill like and this? He Omni Slashed the Tyrant.
Okay, he Omni Slashed. How did he go to
the beats the hell out of me.
I need to look at the top lane a little bit more. But yeah, Sherdils there winning 3 out of 3 lanes. Middle tower is
under attack. We've seen Rival do this to his opponents with the Monkey King in the past. Now he's doing it with the Juggernaut as well. I'm not sure why Darshan just keeps walking in there and dying time and again. He's got 3 deaths as a Tide Hunter. We talked about the Tide being nigh unkillable. But that only, I mean, it's not by, he's not an immortal hero. You've got to make sure you're playing him safe and make sure that you're positioning well. You can't go man fighting versus a Juggernaut when he's got the Omni Slash like this. Look at the level difference as well. Juggernaut is sitting at a comfortable level 9 here, almost level 10, while the offlane Tide has yet to hit level 6. And in comparison, Doom aka Khans is at level 7.5.
Yeah.
Sherdils have absolutely won the early game stage.
This is one of the biggest victories in the early game that I've noticed in a while. A 5,000 net worth lead. I mean, if he had a stats guy, he'd probably be telling us that this is the hugest lead amassed within the 10-minute mark. Beautiful stuff coming out from the Sherdils. They've even got these deep, aggressive wards to keep tab of the Luna, who's now retreated to the jungle to try and catch up. Sherdils are possibly getting a tier 1 for free, unless Darshan and the gang wants to TP in and commit the Ravage. Rival, he's not being contested, but should be aware of the fact that 4 heroes are missing from the map. Bakemono goes in. Radiant's bottom
tower faces a just bump faking it inside.
They're going to blow all the spells open to kill Rival. Rival does have a Blade Fury, he can pop it indeed. He's holding on to it, he's baiting them out. Winter Wyvern with the Winter's Curse TP's in.
I don't know if that was meant to be an attempted gank or what, but it was terrible. Now they're going to go in from behind to try and make this happen Radiant's once again. He's still got the Blade Fury because he was patient the last time around. Diving in like this is not even going to result in a kill, and then they're going to even show their position here.
Okay, Darshan given up. In Khan, he does have Disruption nearby. Disruption doesn't have the epicenter, but the Baro Strike still hurts. Died without items.
Yeah, the
look at this, the Ravage, the Eclipse, they're going to get Khan. Khan sitting on a lot of gold, tries to pop the stick and stay alive while Disruption with the Baro Strike manages to find a killing response. The Lucid Beam brings it really low, the Infused Raindrops helping out. Disruption has a Baro Strike in a bit, the Sands come on cooldown and Invincible to just run him down. They find the kills, they lose the Tidehunter. I mean, it's a victory of sorts for them, but they lost the tier 1 tower while Rival is taking another on the top lane.
It's unfortunate that they have to lose the Tidehunter for that, but he dies for the greater good, getting the 2 kills over to his 1 position 4. Invincible starts shooting up into the network once again, sitting at about 5,000 himself. He's now overtaken the Doom, and it looks like he is targeting the Mantis style of his first item. So, Oh, never mind. He's actually called out the Dragonlance and then going for the Mantis Array. That's fine. I mean, they're both.
Rival has a 13-minute battle fury. Yep. He's got a battle fury. With Phase, Aquila, Bleed Wand as well.
This is Anti-Mage tier farm.
This is a little better than Anti-Mage. I mean, he's done really well for himself. Sherdils, they're working with the number advantage. They have vision of the Crusaders. The question is, what do they want to do with all this deep vision? They're going to possibly pop a smoke and look and find them in the jungle.
They have the Omni Slash available as well, so now is a good time to make a move.
So
they've already taken down the bottom tier one and the mid tier one tower though. So the best thing to do once you've done that is essentially commandeer the enemy jungle. Problem is, I think Crusaders might have seen that smoke. This observer ward may have caught it at the, tail end of it.
It might have just caught the animation. And yeah, the only problem that I think the Sherdils are going to face is that Bakemon is getting closer and closer to his Blink Dagger. Disruption walks in, he does see Remstar, they could go into
the Doom is there,
Disruption goes into the Butter Strike, the Omni Slash is bad. They get the Medusa, it's a kill for Disruption. And a bunch of TPs come out from the Crusaders, but to what avail?
I don't know what Remstar was doing. He dispelled the smoke on the Sand King, he should have seen him. And instead of just beelining straight out of there, he decided to juke in the trees and come back for a second look.
Need some friends.
I mean, they had the high ground advantage. If he was going to stand, he should have popped the stone gaze immediately and started fighting.
Thunder's a hood. He's almost got a vanguard as well. This is where the Titan needs to be. In terms of farming utility. Opal, at this stage, with 4 points in Splinter Blast, he can easily hold off the push in the top lane. Bakemono, he's got his sling. They should be looking to make a whole lot of plays on the back of this. This is the way back for the Crusaders, if there is indeed a way back at all.
Yeah, but at the same time, Disruption's about to get his own Blink Dagger as well. And if you ask me, I'd say the Sand King's Blink is a bit more effective than the Slaughter in this game. But again, the basic tenets of this game do remain in place. Tidehunter and Medusa are fairly tanky zones. If the Doom is down, they can possibly group up and try and make something happen. All they've got to do is really wait for the mechanism to come out on the Tidehunter, and then they should be significantly harder.
Splinter Blast is there, Opa is like a truck, and when Mamacita has to back him up, it's a kill indeed. Sherdils making this look easy.
For lack of a better term, this is just feeding, man. He should not have been past the river like this when he doesn't have a tier 1, let alone a tier 2 tower in that lane. I don't know what he was thinking going out there and farming by himself.
I understand your Medusa, but your Medusa with Ace Boots and then Ogre Axe 15 minutes in, that isn't a lot. Oh, Bakemono, he's gone into the bottom lane, he's going in after Disruption. Disruption, Mighty Close's Blink Dagger. His Butter Strike on cooldown, but the TPs are coming in. Bakemono does have the Blink in 3 too, but the Shrapnel continuously ensuring that the Blink won't be down. Driving closing into the Blade Fury. And that's Disruption Blink.
One at a time, they're just crumbling at this point. It feels like the team has just gone into tilt mode at this moment.
Sherdils making this look extremely easy. Marching down the bottom lane, going for another tier 2. And it seems as if the Crusaders are trying to find a trade, but every time they try and push a lane, Opa TP's in, sees a whole lot of creeps, drops the Splinter Blast, and picks up a whole lot of gold.
Hans, he's ditching the pike, just going for the Vanguard instead. The Crimson Guard is pretty much the smarter choice here.
Definitely needed it. Great for the tower, great for the healer. I'm not a fan without the Winter Wyvern, but they could apply the damage and push. They've gone in though, crush on the Winter Wyvern, keeping that coming in. They've gone in and eliminate the Winter Wyvern, and yes, they have. The Eclipse, well, it's the worst Eclipse I've ever seen. Literally doesn't even connect on a creep. The Eclipse cancels with that Ravage, but Rival ends up going down. Invincible throws a double, Disruption goes in 2-man Butter Strike. The Mech drops from Darshin, but Mamacita with the Master Bandit focuses Darshin and brings him down. Bakemono on the run. Khan giving chase, Disruption low on mana. Darshin have mana for his Butter Strike. Pops a couple of stick charges, ends up picking it up, and manages to secure a kill on the Shadow Demon.
That was an unintentional epicenter cancel with that Ravage. I don't even think he knew the Sand King was channeling it back behind the trees over there. He just got tagged and it was unfortunate because that would have been an epicenter and a blink coming in immediately after the Eclipse. It is a couple of kills going in favor of Crusaders, but the recovery was there from Sherdils. They lost the Juggernaut, but he still got the Omni Slash. There's no Ravage, there's no Eclipse. I think Sherdils just groups up at this point and takes another building, which should be the last remaining outer tower. Or heck, they could even go Roshan with that healing ward and take the Aegis for themselves.
Yep. When you've got an advantage, the trick is to give your enemies as less time and space to recover. And that's what the Sherdils need to be doing. That fight was a little bit of space simply because the Winter Wyvern ended up dying first. Maybe if the Winter Wyvern was around, they wouldn't have even conceded those two kills.
Yeah. You're right, if the Winter Wyvern was around, it's very likely that they've gotten Cold Embrace off, or maybe even the Winter's Curse to slow things down.
Yeah. So what I'm hoping from the Sherdils is possibly a tier 2, heck even Roshan. Get some vision going again. They had phenomenal vision until now. They need to get that vision back. Because they were pretty much safe across the map because they had excellent vision on their opponents. And right now, they're pretty blind. Pop a smoke, buy some wards, get some vision, maybe get a pick off.
Well, Medusa's getting a bit tanky now though. Oh no, never mind, she's not. Remstar actually chose to put 3 points into the split shot right now instead of maxing out the mana shield.
That's a strange choice.
This is confusing to say the least.
This shouldn't be happening. I don't know, maybe he thinks he can farm and pick up an item that's going to make him tanky. Is that the approach here?
Maybe with the Dragonlance phase boots, he's just relying on doing damage. Finally came up for air. Anyway, it looks like Rival and Co. are going to walk into a Shadow Demon who did make illusions of them. Sherdils still on the cover, well, Khans is still on the cover of the smoke, and he's got the full Fusion Guard from the top.
Drop Shield, quick blink. Khan? Oh, heck, that's a complete Crimson Guard.
Yep. So Luna and Medusa no longer will be doing as much damage as they would like.
You know what? I think Sherdils should just mark down that tier 2.
That's what I've been saying. They should have taken an objective while the Ravage and the Eclipse were on cooldown.
Yeah,
they've wasted time.
They have wasted a little bit of time.
I think they did attempt a smoke gang,
which
was spoiled on the high ground. But
now they split back into 3 lanes and they're sort of farming. They just need to regroup a bit. Hey, give up the tier 1 in the mid lane. Pick up the last remaining tier 2 tower and get some vision going once more. Nice, yellow circle being drawn out by disruption as to where the majority of the Crusaders are, but Rival still farming into the city.
He is near a Radiant Observer ward as well.
This is in good positioning. He can't have TPs coming in quick enough to keep him alive. He's only got a Battle Fury. Yeah, now they know where Rival is. He's running back in. They're probably going to move in his direction. Okay. Dashin just TPs to the top lane.
He's just trying to be as efficient as possible. The fact that Crusaders are so scared to go for this gank is really a troublesome sign at this point. But Invincible, he did finish up a Yasha now and has the Manta recipe. Soon enough, that Illusion Army will be available on the battlefield and they're not going to have a response to it. Sherdils cannot afford to waste too much time, else they're going to be punished by the Illusion push.
But the strength of the Illusion Army right now is rather weak. I mean, a Maelstrom and Sniper, Shrapnel, Splinter Blast, they can deal with the Illusions. I think they're going to be able to deal with the Illusions for now, but they are indeed wasting that. Ravage was on cooldown, Eclipse was on cooldown, and all they did was run around and pick up an Illusion rune.
But yeah, I think Crusaders, they're finally finding the groove here. They've just got to wait for Darshan to pick up the Blink Dagger next, and then they're going to have a way to start the fight on their terms. Sherdils, though, not choosing to allow them that liberty. They will pop a smoke and try and make something happen again. But look at how scared Crusaders are. They're just sticking as a small little ball in one general area. That could work against them.
Corruption, he's got the chance. Two-man bow strike, Wade goes for the Shadow Demon. Doom up on the Luna. The control Invincible, he's trying his best. The Demonic Point up on Khans. The Khans is running in. Darshan, Ravage connects on all of them, but they've lost the Luna. And Remstar comes running in with the Stone Gaze. Doesn't really manage to clip onto anybody. The Windows Curse will ensure that Darshan takes a whole lot of damage from his own teammate. And the Omni Slash, coupled up with the Battle Strike, ensures a kill on the Tide. They're moving on to Remstar. Disruption has a Battle Strike in 5 seconds. Rival doesn't have a defusive lane. They're chasing Remstar to the Zord base. Remstar low on mana. The play series there, along with the Disruption. Opa's even walked in. And the Cold Embrace is going to buy Rivals to Tide. Khans is taking it out. It's stupid attempting to do that, but it's not going to amount to too much.
That's 4 down for the price of none on the side of Sherdils. This is just annihilation coming out. and that was after they saw the fight breaking out. Yeah. I mean, the Luna had all the time in the world to pop the Eclipse, but Invincible hesitated. He just waited and watched them in his face. He tried to get in all the way close to the low ground before he popped the Eclipse, and that's when the Doom decided to Doom her instead. No Eclipse for that fight. The Ravage comes in a tad bit too late. Slara comes in from behind, so when the Stone Gaze was upon the Sniper and both, they simply turned their backs to Medusa and found a preview on the Sniper on the Slara behind.
There's no real follow-up, but Calm is still manning up over there. He's taken a fair amount of damage. The Glaives are doing their bit, and it seems as if the Sherdils are going to retreat without losing any members. Bakemono needs to find the crush. It's splitting up, but it's still a decent human crush. They've got the Sniper, they've got Khan, but the Khoj do not want to chase. Sherdils pick up a tier 1.
A tier 3.
A tier 3.
And make a clean escape. That's that could be the first nail in their coffin on the side of Crusaders. Now their base has been left as a victim of deformity here, and I mean, Sherdils could simply take Roshan, move to the shrines, and come back with an Aegis cheese and new items to finish what they started. Blink Dagger has been queued up by Riven. He's already got the Mantisal online. Mamacita, he's standing a mile and a half away and slapping the hell out of Remstar's face there in this fight. It's a dirty trick that they're using, but one that's proving to be super effective. Hans, I mean, he's got high priority Doom targets at this point. The Ravage is not going to be as impactful as an Eclipse were, and he's picking and choosing his targets perfectly. Perhaps a Blink Dagger on Khans would be the game changer, or at least it would be the it'll be the tool that Khans and boys need to finish this game.
Yeah.
And that's what he's queued up.
He's also got the Hurricane fight completed on the Sniper, so good luck trying to catch up with it. He's got the Manta style, he's going for the Blink. I like the Blink pickup.
Yeah, I think the Blink is pretty much a necessity at this point for the Juggernaut.
Nashin got the Blink along with his mech. His Ravage is hitting a whole bunch. But where's the follow-up? The Medusa is the Dragon Lance and a plus 25 damage talent.
They're trying to bring down Radiant's top.
The Luna.
That's so underwhelming at this point.
The Luna is having to fight as well as some power, but she needs to take a Lich.
Remstar, I mean, that's a cute attempt coming up from him trying to get to push a tier 1 tower, but his base is about to be made into a football game.
I honestly don't think they can. Sheldon's on care. The Luna illusion's hurt, but Sheldon's going to push
Okay, there's smoke. Watch it. There's the jumping! All five!
Where's the follow-up? They're going in on Mamacita, who manages to run away. The Wither goes it's a kill upon disruption. It's a kill upon the Tidehunter. And they're moving in for Remstar. The assassination there to secure the kill and count the disruption. They're having fun with Sent in here. They've jumped in deep. They're going to back off. They've got to refocus itself and move for a second. Mamacita managed to kill off the Saturday Mint. The bank met many characters have fallen as well.
That was the Opa show, man. That was the Opa show. He put a full stop to that fight with the Winter Skulls right in the middle of the day. After a five-man Ravage, he prevents the Eclipse from coming out in time. Yeah. Beautiful stuff coming out from the Winter Wyvern. And I mean, you called it, right? MVPs are rarely given the five positions, but I think for that fight, he possibly deserves it. Anyway,
I don't know how the gross their tower. It's so hard for them. Khan jumped in the team, but they might have killed Khan. But they can hit Opa with the golden brace, keeping Khan alive. They could turn this around destruction with the butter strike. Mamacita with the damage, they managed to take the starter. Dashi goes in with the mech, but that mech, it doesn't keep him alive too long. And they're finally going to be able to push out the Sherdils. The Sherdils still have the Aegis on the Juggernaut. He's linked there by Darshan giving chase. Throws out the Gush upon Mamacita.
Yeah, they
can heal up and just...
Yeah, they've all TP'd out, but they've gotten two lanes of barracks now. Just the range barracks standing on the bottom lane. And they've still got shrines that they can take out on their way out. This is just salt into the wounds of Crusaders. I mean, I want to say that the Sherdils have played amazing Dota, but the fact is Crusaders have played horrible Dota.
Yeah, I mean, if there's a takeaway for the Crusaders from this game, it's that Remstar needs to take a look at his work in the mid lane.
Not just the mid lane, man. Even the mid game, he's walking out farming by himself as
someone
that's meant to be the core, the tank of the team. He chooses to go for the skill build that's meant to do damage instead of tank. This is some very questionable stuff coming out from him. The priority should have been on his Lincoln Sphere, not on the Dragonlance. If he had to go for the Dragonlance, he shouldn't have been dying time and again after.
I think the philosophy behind the Dragonlance is that he realized that he lost his lane horribly and he just wanted some stats.
Yeah, that makes sense. But even so, I can't really forgive the deaths on the middle lane time and again.
Yeah. Khan's has been decent. Pretty good actually in the Doom, always catching the Luna. And if all the teams in Ucypher that especially keep picking the Doom are looking for a replay on how to make the Doom work, I guess this is it.
Rival, he picked up the Blink Dagger a while ago, but he hasn't had the opportunity to call it out to himself. Looks like he doesn't even care about it. Going for the chase, he's going for the jugular. Rabbit, the Eclipse, all available now. Can they take a successful team fight here at Crusaders?
I mean, they did the last time around. They've smoked up and they're looking for the wraparound.
I mean, they haven't even taken the
initiative. That is the bad observer. Khan is moving in their direction. Look for the initiation. Plenty goes in, dark to the Rabbit Man. Catch a couple for disruption, not in that Rabbit. They will usually the Mamacita first. Look for the epicenter. With the Richard Source on top. Kind of in the but the Sherdils, they have to back off for now. Opa trying to slow them down. Omnistar is coming out from the Juggernaut. This should be a kill on Bakimono. But instead, it's a boom upon the Medusa. Disruption, two-man butter strike. Rival team just go again. And with the Blade Team, he's just going to run down the Crusaders. He eliminates Darshan. He's chasing Remstar to his own base. He hasn't got the Omnistar, but he's got the Manta style. And he's going to attempt to man up.
Oh, the Aegis time down.
One keep him alive from the gush. Bakimono going in for round two. Both Juggernaut as well as Sniper dead. But the Splinter Blast, along with the Arctic Bird, might do something as well, but stop them though, keeping them alive. Bakimono manages to survive, and Invincible should be able to clean out. He eliminates the Winter Wyvern, he's moving in after Khan, whose Crimson Guard is on cooldown. He's second suddenly comes back up. Bakimono returns his base, he's found by the man up to the kill, but Bakimono is gonna burn down. Then he comes from the double, that's a whole lot of gold, that's his linking skill complete. A solid tier of gold, and what really went wrong is that
Shadow Demon got.
Yep, that was really the mistake. That the crucial mistake that should have like communication between Opa and a wasted epicenter, pretty much a wasted discourse as well, because if I'm not mistaken, Senjin was standing on the back lines with the disruption ready to protect Zero. He's played some phenomenal Dota and throughout this last team fight, Senjin's been protecting the core time and again. He's protected Bakimono a couple of times as well. But Bakimono does end up going down at the tail end of it because of another whiff crush, which is entirely his own fault. They defend their high ground, they're sure they lose their tier 3 tower, but the high ground still stands and the Mega Creeps are not going to survive just yet. But at middle lane, his disruption looks so good.
But
Ucypher
might die. He's
also got the Bastion. There was also this unfortunate moment in that last fight where the Aegis timed out somewhere over the duration of that fight and Rival went in deep, but he was knocked down. He might have thought he had a secondary life, but unfortunately, Roshan reclaimed what was his. No hesitation, no Sherdils, just coming back to finish what they started.
Yeah, they've got the Blinker Nopa. They made the fallacy of not getting the Blinker slow down to the Juggernaut, but now he has it. Long time to stop that, so healing was
That's four down on the side of Sherdils. This is the second time it's happened. The gold slings are coming online time and again, and this time nobody dies on the side of Crusaders. Are we seeing a comeback from the depths of hell here? Khan's wasn't a part of that fight. He chose not to join at all. This is absolutely questionable on his part. If anything, he should be the one jumping in and creating space while they were beating up on the final melee barracks. But Crusaders, they smell blood in the water. They're going to go through the middle lane, and this is when that illusion army is going to start hurting. Heck, they could go straight for the jugular, take down the tier 3, and move forward for the barracks as well. If they get a later barracks here, at least they're going to even out the middle lane.
Dire structures are fortified. Dire's middle tower is crowded.
Dire's middle tower has fallen. This is when things are going to get really tricky for the Sherdils.
Dire's middle tower is under pressure.
That's just illusion. That's not even real.
Fortune. Dire are scanning for enemies.
It cost them buybacks.
It's also bottom racks.
Yeah. Bottom racks went a while ago, actually. They went in and took it after they took the middle racks. They just left the range barracks. So.
Okay. Solid Sands is the many barracks in the top lane.
I'll just talk about how Crusaders.
Yeah, but they've been defending this top lane with their lives. Yeah. Honestly, I see it happening for Crusaders. They have the opportunity.
Take that as tribute. Go.
dire are scanning for enemies.
Don't mind if I do.
I was practicing my backstroke.
Mamacita's double damage has been spotted, but the real storyline is that newly picked up refresher up on Darshan's Tidehunter. What's crucial to remember here is if Medusa and Co. do manage to get a team wipe, barreling down a lane and taking buildings is really easy.
It's very easy. They can throne them. The Sherdils don't have buyback.
Yeah, one good push and they can break the throne right away. It's really not that tall of an order.
Up and down, right?
All eyes on Darshan. He has to be the superstar for this game.
Mamacita is taking up the role of taking second carry, but that
is
Cypher
He does a lot of damage.
Illusions he has now range. Trumping the Juggernaut illusions.
I got it.
And right, you've got a butterfly on the Luna. Mamacita picked up his MKB. No, not yet.
So Mamacita, the in-game
is all upon second carry. And Invincible is staying alive. I mean, I think Invincible is okay getting two. He still hits like a truck.
Attack rate?
Yeah, I mean, he's okay with two moves, honestly. But why would he get two? Two moves on his side.
Yeah.
No, wait, I'm so sorry. Yeah, Invincible's okay with getting doomed, but I think Tide is the same. Mama,
he's not taking him either. He's second carry.
I don't think they know about
that. He's got a Kaiser, got a Kaiser. Ab wo damage kaafi karta
hai. He has attack rate.
Now this
exactly does not have to be the tower.
No one on the side of the tower.
He's got the tower.
Tower.
It's only for them to leave their base when you just fight.
He's
going to attack the tower. He's here to
work.
And then you're fighting without the Juggernaut versus all five on the other side. You don't need to fight more than
Doom comes there, he puts his last power, ultimate power, which basically damages.
You feel stupid just saying it, don't matter.
No, hold on, wait, let's just see how this pans out. I'm very curious to see how this pans out. They ish, yeah.
Overtime,
they should know that they're setting illusions. So they gotta be careful.
Silence is overtime damage. I was going to say silence after that. Exactly.
How's Medusa looking? The Skadi, she has the money to purchase it, but no way to get to the shop. They're really hoping that either the Medusa or the courier goes to the shop and they can kill at least one of them. But I'm pretty certain Opa would have gotten an AFK abandoned by this point. Like, really. It's just
okay. I'll just say, I'll explain the power. I'll just take the ground. Epicenter.
He's out there again. No smokes being purchased either. They have a smoke on Sengen actually. No, they have a smoke on Sengen, so they could try and position well with that.
So they have two really good initiators.
Rival meanwhile, looks like he's turning into a butterfly of his own. He has the money to buy. It's not like he has the money for a buyback either.
And over time, he's damaged. He's all damaged.
But
then you have Tiny, who basically stuns your opponent.
This game, the hard reset button has been hit once again.
Everyone in the vicinity of that.
With buybacks coming online for almost everyone again.
And about my favorite player, Invincible. I mean, why can't he work with magic? Because he's been playing so well.
I'll take your
out
of here. Well, I predicted another 30 minutes.
Yeah, but did you factor in pause time over there?
No.
One by one, everyone wants to go take a
break.
A couple of teams take it.
Let's see if that happens.
My DOTA 2 is still on. Let's see if Crusaders win last
game. Radiant's Gloria was drowned in a pool of blood.
Crusaders had a already good game this game out, but they went and recklessly tried that. One of the most crucial mistakes, and it's uncharacteristic of a player like Khan, is he chose not to come for one of the finest pushes.
Yeah.
Without the Doom available, the Tide smacked the Ravage on both the Sniper as well as the Juggernaut. They cleaned them up one after
one. But one way of looking at it is that maybe Khan told them that I'm not there and the team decided to go in.
Yeah, it's also a possibility that it was Khan's fault and it was the team's fault. But
they decided to get carried away and push his fourth. And I don't know, either way, it's a lack of communication between the teams.
Anyway, Roshan's going to respawn in another minute and that's probably what everyone is waiting for. I don't really see a way for Crusaders to contest Rosh, especially given how heavily the area around has been falling.
They got smoke on Sengen.
Okay, looks like the Radiant Courier was sniped. I don't know if there's, no, there's nothing on it. But it also means that they can't call out the Skadi for that. You also gotta remember that Bash now pierces vision, so if you don't have to here we go. The illusion push, the slow and steady illusion and sniper push is coming out here. Then pulling out the caution things on the sniper, but he's gonna hurricane fight back up with the high ground. Many barracks down to about half HP. Instant repeat is the name of the game for Sherdils, but they've gotta watch out for Crush and Tidehunter, who's ready to go at a moment's notice. Never mind, they're gonna back away and go Roshan instead. What was the point of sieging that many barracks then?
It's gonna be Roshan with the refresher shot.
Oh, they know.
I mean, they're going to contest. This is an all-in contest. If anybody can have a contest, Juggernaut is making the dire cannon. And Mark they're just moving to where the old enemy shrine used to be. Khans needs to be careful. He could get caught in the crush, but he pops his BKB and he's running right back at them. The Omni Slash upon Senjin, but he disrupts himself and runs right back.
Watch
Invincible, doomed. They should be able to bring down the Luna, but nobody's focusing her. Khans dropping low. Mamacita in the battle of his own disruption with the epicenter. Once again, the Winter's Curse upon him, and Invincible is just pounding away. Opa meant to bring down Makimura, but falls to Invincible as well. And the Omni Slash was wasted by Heisenberg.
So Darshan ends up popping a Ravage that catches a whole bunch of heroes. They only end up getting one for one. Both sides losing supports. Ty make a bit of a crucial mistake. They're not popping the Refresher Orb after the Ravage immediately. Even if you're not going to use it, it's always best to just pop the Refresher Orb onto the Ravage instead of waiting on to get the cooldown. But there's always a chance that they're going to push now and you'll be forced to pop the Refresher and have the Refresher on cooldown instead of having two Ravages after 120 seconds. We're going to go back into the rush pick. Sherdils will pick up the Aegis. With that Aegis, they're almost certainly going to come battling down that top lane, and that means that the Tyre has been a really good best. My last 5 minutes, this is a desperation in Khans' eyes. He's BKB, Scorcher, and just starts running into the fight, hoping to find the Ultimate. And he turns around and runs away. This isn't Dota, this is an episode of Tommy.
Oh, disruption, though, he's got Invincible. Okay, I'm going to jump onto Mamacita, wanting to, but with the master manager, the cheese, he's going to disruption goes in with the Ravage. He wants to focus Mamacita, demonic pulse upon rival. They want to bring down the Juggernaut, but the Juggernaut has the Aegis and Mamacita has the cheese. He pops it, he turns around, rival, his Aegis is going to be taken away. Khans pops his BKB and runs right in, a missed array of spells, and Bakimono with the crush. This is another death on the Slada, 68 seconds without him.
What was he thinking? His team was so far out, he goes in and crushes the BKB sniper and ends up losing his life for free.
Oh, look at this. Khans has gone in. He wants to control Darshan. He pops his BKB. The Doom is there upon the Tide Hunter, but he's dropping low. Here's Epicenter number 2 coming out. It's not done too much. They're focusing Remstar, and Khans will get the kill with the Infernal Blade. It's a buyback on the Luna. It's a buyback on the Medusa, and all they've got is a Shadow Demon to help them out. Demonic Purge upon rival. Opa blinks in. Winter's Curse upon the Shadow Demon. Just controlling him, not doing any real work. The Bottle Strike will miss because the Xena, excuse me, the Medusa has a Lincoln Spear. Rival dropping low. He still has the Aegis, and Mamacita pops the Master Bandage, wants to focus the Tier 4s here. Invincible goes in with the Eclipse, but it's upon Mamacita, who was undercover of the Disruption, who just pops a Glimmer Cape and runs right back. Disruption runs past the Luna, almost ends up going down, while Rival jumps in, his Aegis taken away. He's respawning for round 2. He doesn't have the Omni Slash, but he jumps in and pops some Blade Fury once more. This is a little silly, but they're going to get the Tier 4. Khans runs in with the green. Finally, they've got the Battle Strike up on the Luna. The Stone Gaze is there. They've lost Sengen. Luna needs to be careful. He's lining up. He pops the damage. He's focusing the Winter Wild and just gets that kill out of the way he needs. Khans still running around like a headless chicken. Rival running right back. Khans all by himself, but he's got disrupted. The Battle Strike is there. The crush is second too late. And once again, all that stands for the Crusaders is the throne.
They somehow managed to keep this game still going. Sherdils came in with Bloodlust ready to end the game, and they get repelled once more. However, this time they have Mega Creeps tilting in their favor. The problem is they did sacrifice their Aegis and their cheese in the last fight. The question is, does Sherdils wait once again, or did they go and end the game without the Aegis and the cheese this time?
Try now, beat up and just go once more. Rival has a double damage rune. For safety, I think he should call out his Abyss Spell, otherwise maybe just die, buy back. He stands for a second, looks at the Luna, stands for another. Pops the Omni Slash, Invincible doesn't have the mana, excuse me, the mana voice, and that's the Battle Strike. Followed by the Ravage, who kills who is the question. Luna running back, Bakumono dropping low, and Invincible forced us forward, pops the Flutter, hopes to bring down rival of Mamacita. And Mamacita pops his BKB and takes Bakumono on the side. The Mr. Father is responding in a bit. All Mamacita's got to do is focus the throne. Does Darshan have another Ravage?
His
Refresher
back.
Coming off cooldown in 5 seconds. They could go once more. Can they really hold on the side of the Crusaders?
Invincible's even gone for the Mask of Madness over and above the Satanic, so he just wants to hit hard and fast here. Buying cheap items to help him defend while his base is in turmoil. This is this is so clutch from Crusaders. If they can turn this around somehow, it'll be the most immense comeback of Ucypher so far. But
I mean, if there was a lineup that could defend against pieces, Luna Medusa. Disruption goes in, Barrow Strike upon Invincible. Where's the follow-up? The follow-up is Darshan with the Ravage. It catches a bunch of them. They're running at Mamacita. Mamacita saved by the Cold Embrace. Dude. Khan's in the middle of battle. The Stone Gaze pop. They're pushing them right back. They're trying to focus Mamacita. Mamacita dropping low. Where's the save? There's Disruption. Three-man Barrow Strike, but the damage has been done. They've lost Mamacita. Invincible runs right back with the Doom upon him. Rival pops the Blade Fury, hopes to secure a retreat, and Khan's unlucky will end up going down. The Sherdils fail to penetrate into the Crusaders' base, and the Crusaders, they're still holding on versus Mega Creeps.
49 minutes in. I don't even know how Crusaders are still in this. Just a few seconds ago, it was a 34,000 net worth advantage in favor of Sherdils. Now it's only a 29,000 net worth advantage in favor of Sherdils. Slowly, this is being eroded, and you can see Crusaders getting ready and prepped to push themselves. They're battling down the middle lane. There's no buyback on the Doom. They're going to have to fight 4 versus 5 here, but someone has to deal with the Mega Creeps in the base that are going in on an exposed ancient.
Medusa. Remstar's going to catch up and farm.
Luna had a fair amount of gold as well. She's queued up another butterfly for some reason.
The talk around the set is Hawa is suddenly making a comeback. We're still not sure if it's a comeback, but there is a chance that with the Shadow Demon and the Luna, they could do some serious structural damage here.
Rival and Disruption, they're out of no man's land.
It's funny that Rival sees a butterfly and builds one of his own.
What? Hasn't anyone heard of an MKB in this game?
I mean, only Mamacita. And he's been delayed for a long time. He had that queued up since a while. I'm not sure where all this excess net worth is coming from for the Sherdils. But yeah, they're the ones with the net worth advantage. Guys, come on. Invincible, if you're not going to push now, you're never going to push.
Yeah, you're never going to get like this.
Rival on the hunt, sees Senjin. Please don't omni slash him. Okay, Senjin turns around. What is this?
Just playing with him with the race rune. Okay, Invincible. He's going to swap out that Mask of Madness for a butterfly, I hope. Yep, there is the secondary Eagle Song. Not only does he have evasion, he has 37 armor.
Yeah.
That's more than enough to deal with everything that the sniper as well as the juggernaut are throwing at him.
The Luna is becoming a bit hard to kill on.
Opa's the one that's going for a Lotus Orb of all heroes. I just don't see why.
Corrosive Ace. Disruption.
That's totally not worth it.
Ghost Scepter would be nice actually, Princess.
It really would. I'd have liked to see some Lotus Orbs coming out on the Radiant side, but they're too busy defending their base right now to even bother with thinking of their items, apparently. Shadow Demon went for the 4-star. Tyrant is still no Lotus Orb. Bakemono is still going for the BKB, which is going to be absolutely pointless. And the Ancient's back up to full HP with the Fortification available. Let's not forget the fact that neither the Luna or the Medusa have a buyback available now. But they're both packing a major puncher.
Darshan's picked up a Shadow Blade. Zopa have detection, he's got dust. So this could be a bit of a surprise for...
I mean, Disruption does have a gem on him.
Yeah, but no one on the side of the Sherdils has any detection.
Oh, I like what he's doing though. He's going for the Nullifier this game.
On whom?
On the Sand King.
Okay.
A Nullifier on Invincible sounds huge, but only when Senjin's not around to save his buddy.
This will come in handy.
You think Khan should have gone for a Nullifier as well?
What's he chosen to go for instead?
He picked up the Shield Guard and the BKB, but his next item, if he does manage to find a slot, could be the Nullifier to replace the Hood.
Yeah, I think that's not a bad choice at all.
Rival, no True Strike. Mamacita has some kind move.
And Roshan can come back online in about a minute's time. I think this is where Invincible and Co. decide whether or not they want to contest. How the only real problem I see for Crusaders is how do they ever leave their base to go end the game on the other side? And they have no buildings except the Ancients. It's going to take a 5-man dieback inside the Radiant base by the Dyers for Crusaders to actually go and end. And that only happens if Sherdils get impatient. I don't think this game is ever going to get to a point where the Luna can push out by herself and end the game.
You know, Riven's itemization is a little hilarious. He picked up the Moon Charge just now, if I'm not mistaken.
Yep, he did. But who did he give it over to?
Did he sell it?
Or? I think he bought it and sold it off immediately.
Okay. But honestly, he's got all these items that are meant for him to...
Oh, there it is. He consumes it now.
And he spends more of his time popping Blade Fury in.
Yeah, this is the most confusing bit for me as well.
It's not like
he took the Blade Fury DPS challenge. At this point, Blade Fury should only be used to deal with the Eclipse of the Rams. Nothing else. I also think Remstar might be thinking of the Divine Nature as his next item. He is at level 25 and he chose to get the extra split shot down to deal with the Mega Creature. Doesn't have too much attack speed to work with, but if he proves to be another source of damage alongside that Luna, I think they have what it takes to try and end the game.
I think he's gonna be a question. Really step up his cursing.
Yep.
Anyway, Sherdils, Aegis, Chase, a refresher card. And
the Shin has a good opportunity here. I don't know why he didn't go in. That was a chance to jump in and catch four with the rabbit. Maybe he didn't see them, but.
Defense of the Ancients at its finest here. Sherdils is too close to game. Just pushing in. There, Butterfly not doing too much. Secondary Butterfly not yet complete on Invincible. The Winter's Curse
what?
Is there. It just holds the Luna in place. He's standing stationary, tanking.
What's Rival doing?
The Butterfly. There's the Ravage. Manages to catch two of them. Ravage number two, Invincible and Remstar moving in. You got the Stone Gazer trying to focus down the Sniper. And indeed they will. There's a Doom upon Darshan, but that's after he's committed to Ravages. Rival all by himself, controlled by the Crusaders. Are the Crusaders really going to make a comeback here? Disruption has the epicenter, but I don't think that's going to be enough. The Omni Slash not available, and I'm not sure if it did enough in the first place itself. He's popping that Blade Fury, hoping to run, but they've got four staffs galore. They wipe out the Sniper, the Juggernaut who had Aegis upon him, and they even make the Doom look silly and ineffective.
Sherdils, if I was a betting man, I'd probably call them out for foul play here, because that looked like an absolute throw. You had Doom as well as the Juggernaut jumping all the way on the back lines to Doom and Omni Slash a bloody Shadow Demon.
I don't think he even got that done.
No, they got the kill. I think he bought back over there. Yeah, he bought back on that side. And then the Refresher Orb was on the Doom. He pops the Refresher, comes... Wait, he had a Refresher Orb. He had a Refresher Shard, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
He pops the Refresher Shard, comes back, and Doom's Tidehunter who's popped two Ravages. But that's a Divine Rapier! On the floor, what have you done, Crusaders?
Khan just the Divine Rapier. Remstar. The woes of the mid lane still carrying on into the late game here. Invincible picking up his secondary butterfly. Can Opa hit one impactful curse? It's all it's going to take for Senjin or Darshan to fall at the very least. Invincible, he's just marching up. Opa, Splinter Blast on cooldown. Invincible forcing racks here. Disruption goes in with the butterstrike. Darshan doesn't have the Ravage. It's not going to do too much good even standing out. Look at Opa! The glaives! Jesus.
That's without the Divine Rapier on Medusa as well. Medusa is just busy farming the bottom lane, trying to farm another Divine Rapier.
I mean,
but
they got the range barracks for a reason, right?
They got the range barracks. Crusaders have actually breached high ground for the first time.
This comes with an Alpha Wolf and a Divine Rapier. A devout Alpha Wolf and a Divine Rapier. Huh.
I actually think he's the wrong person to be holding out a Rapier at this. I mean, it's better than having it on the Medusa, but it was just careless coming up from Remstar to not keep his eyes on the courier while purchasing the Rapier of all.
Yeah.
It's honestly, I know he's the captain and he's supposed to be the experienced guard of Dota 2, but he's really been slacking this game. And there's one of the primary reasons why Invincible and his boys are in this position, or why Crusaders are in this position, is because Remstar was completely lackluster in the mid game, and now he's even throwing away the advantage in the late game when his team is trying so hard to keep him in it.
They smoked up the Hanging Man Ravel. Ravel still not got any true strike. 58 minutes in, so he has no direct answer to the Luna. Khan's zanging around with the Divine Rapier and the BKB. I'd be pleased to just see him doom and right-click someone. They go in with the Battle Strike. Bossman are going to survive. Ravel goes in with the Omni Slash. The Abyssal thrown out upon the Slaughter. The Omni Slash does a little bit of work, but not enough. There's the Eclipse, but an immediate doom upon Dashin means there won't be a Ravage. Mamacita brings down Bakimoto and Khan's turning it out.